نحمده ونصلي على رسوله الكريم، أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي، ربي زدني علما، اللهم فقهنا في الدين، اللهم بارك لنا في أوقاتنا، صلى الله عليه وسلم. So in the last program, we had been discussing how the people of Quraysh turned against the message and how they were trying their level best to stop this message from propagating. So today we are going to discuss the various strategies that they adopted to stop the message of Allah from spreading to the others. First of all, the strategy that they adopted was to make fun of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and to taunt him. Some other strategies that they used were to contempt him, mock him. In Surah 15, ayat number 6, they said,
وَقَالُوا يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِي نُزِّلَ عَلَيْهِ الذِّكْرُ إِنَّكَ لَمَجْنُونَ.
And they say, O you to whom the Quran is sent down, verily you are a lunatic. Astaghfirullah. They used to call Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam a madman. In Surah number 38, ayat number 4, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
وَعَجِبُوا أَن جَاءَهُمْ مُنذِرٌ مِّنْهُمْ وَقَالَ الْكَافِرُونَ هَذَا سَاحِرٌ كَذَّابٌ.
And they wonder that a warner has come to them from among themselves, and the disbelievers say, this is a sorcerer, a liar. So they used to say different things about Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and this shows us that they couldn't agree on one thing because it was all wrong, nothing was right. So sometimes they would be calling him a madman, astaghfirullah, sometimes they would be calling him a sorcerer, a magician, sometimes they would call him a liar. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Hijr, ayat number 97,
وَلَقَدْ نَعْلَمُ أَنَّكَ يَضِيقُ صَدْرُكَ بِمَا يَقُولُونَ.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we know that your breast is distressed by what they say. Now Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was a human being. He was not something supernatural. The difference between him and any other human being is that he was a messenger of Allah. Allah's revelations used to come on him. So Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to get hurt, like any one of us would get hurt. Imagine somebody calling us liars, like if somebody calls us that you're mad, or somebody says that you have made up this Quran, you have fabricated it, it's all lies, it's not true, or that you are a magician, how would we feel? So Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam would be hurt. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told him, ayat number 98 in Surah Al-Hijr,
فَسَبِّحْ بِحَمْدِ رَبِّكَ وَكُمْ مِنَ السَّاجِدِينَ.
Therefore magnify the praises of your Lord and be among those who prostrate themselves before him. This is an ayat sajida. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told him that when these people are saying such things to you which hurt you, what should you be doing? Glorify the praise of Allah. Fasabbih bihamdi rabbika, and do sajda to Allah, meaning read prayers, do sajda to Allah. Is there a lesson in this for you and me? Yes, there is a beautiful lesson. If people sometimes mistreat us, if they are unjust to us, if they say things which are not true, things which hurt us, what should we be doing? We should be following in the role model of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We should do sabr for the sake of Allah and glorify Allah. and speak to Allah about our problems, about our trouble, cry our hearts out to Allah. Maybe at tahajjud time, read prayers, go in sajda and pray to Allah. Because every power is in the hand of Allah. When we start confiding in others, when we start revealing all our troubles to others, what happens? People start shunning us. They say, the crybaby is here again. She'll just come here and make our moods off also. So we should not, and also not only that, but also people then convey to others. And then sometimes we lose face, we become very sad that our message has been leaked out to others. So the best thing to do is when we are hurt, to confide to Allah, to pray to Allah, to glorify Allah, do tasbih of Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah 83, ayat 29-33.
إِنَّ الَّذِينَ أَجْرَمُوا كَانُوا مِنَ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا يَضْحَكُونَ وَإِذَا مَرُّوا بِهِمْ يَتَغَامَزُونَ وَإِذَا انْقَلَبُوا إِلَى أَهْلِهِمْ انْقَلَبُوا فَكِهِينَ وَإِذَا رَأَوْهُمْ قَالُوا إِنَّ هَؤُلَاءِ لَضَالُّونَ وَمَا أُرْسِلُوا عَلَيْهِمْ حَافِظِينَ.
Verily those who committed crimes, meaning these disbelievers, they used to laugh at those who believe. So this was another way to demoralize the Muslims. Whenever a group of Muslims would pass by, they would make fun of them and laugh at them. And whenever they passed by them, they used to wink one to another. Imagine when you are passing with your friend and somebody is winking and pointing at you and making fun, how would we feel? So this is what the kuffar of Makkah used to do. And when they returned to their own people, they'd return jesting. And when they saw them, they said, verily, these people, they've gone astray. So the Muslims, the people who were guided, they used to call them the misguided people. But they had not been sent as watchers over them. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about the believers, we had not sent you to watch over these people. Let them do what they are doing. They are accountable for their sins. Then another strategy that these kuffar of Makkah used to use was that they would sometimes distort the message. Whenever Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was preaching, they would give wrong interpretations of the message and convey that to others. They would distort the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And sometimes they would create doubts in the minds of the people. At other times, they would give out false allegations against Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and against the Muslims. And they would give out false propaganda against the Muslims. They would slander and humiliate Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And why were they doing all this? They were doing all this to humiliate Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam so much that nobody would bother to go and listen to his words. This was their strategy, that they would try to insult him so much that nobody would want to come and listen to him. So this was one strategy that they were using. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in the fifth year of prophethood, he recited Surah Al-Najm before a large gathering. So then Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what was his strategy? What was his response to all these cheap strategies that the disbelievers were using to stop the message from propagating? Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam would recite the Quran to them. And we can also use this strategy. Whenever we are talking to others, we can use the message of the Quran. We can use the strategies used by Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in our own daily lives as well. Also, whenever Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to recite the Quran, they would say, Asatirul Awwaleen. They would say, these are just tales of the ancient people. Whatever he is repeating, the story of Musa alayhi salam, Isa alayhi salam, these are all ancient legends, fables, and he is inventing them all up. Sometimes they would say that there is a man who is dictating all this to him and he is memorizing it and saying all these things. Sometimes they would say that these are just confused dreams which he has at night, and in the morning he starts narrating it to others. And sometimes they would say that he has concocted up everything, he is inventing all these are all lies. Astaghfirullah. So this is how they would try to put down the message of Allah. They would say, Asatirul Awwaleen iktatabaha fahiya tumla alayhi bukratan wa asila. Surah number 25, ayat number 5. These are tales of the ancients which he has written down, and they are dictated to him morning and afternoon. Allah and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, despite all this, he would go on reciting the Quran in his prayers. But what happened was that whenever Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam recited the Quran in his prayers, these people, they would make fun of not just the Quran, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself and also Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Allah's commandment came, Suratul Isra, ayat number 110.
وَلَا تَجْهَرْ بِصَلَاتِكَ وَلَا تُخَافِتْ بِهَا وَابْتَغِ بَيْنَ ذَلِكَ سَبِيلًا.
Recite your prayers neither in a very loud voice nor silently, but follow a middle course. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, do not recite the Quran loudly in your prayers, but do not recite it in your heart also. Find a middle ground. So recite it in whispers in a way which these kuffar cannot hear, because otherwise, astaghfirullah, na'uzubillah, they had started making fun of Allah, started making fun of the Quran and of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. There was a man called Nadhr bin Haris. He went a step further. What he did was, he went to Hira in Syria and he came back with the legends of Darius, Dara, Sikandar, Alexander and Isfandiyar, a Persian king. He came back with these tales and stories and legends. And whenever he heard that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was going to address a group of people, he would go there first and start narrating these tales. Like a movie, like a drama, he would start making up these tales of these people and he would start narrating those tales. Why? Why did he do that?
To misguide people, of course.
To take people's attention away from the Quran. So that the people will get so enraptured in these dramas and tales and legends and they would pay no attention to the Quran. Isn't this what is happening today also? Yes. People have become so engrossed in all these false stories that are going around in the form of dramas and movies and false novels, fiction, etc. People are so engrossed in it, they have no time for the Quran. They have no time for the seerah, no time to read about hadith. Why?
So, yes. Yes. We are so curious to watch the next episode of any drama, but no time to...
No time to know what Allah says next in the next surah. We have no time for that. So engrossed in this world and it all the glamour it has to offer. This is the satanic trap. This is shaitan's voice. This is how shaitan is taking us away from our real mission in life. The real benefit that we have, the way to achieve Jannah, is through learning about the Quran and Hadith and following it. That is Siratul Mustaqim. And this is how the shaitan takes us away from that. Nadhr bin Haris also went and bought singing girls, slave girls who were experts in singing and dancing. And whenever he found that some person was getting inclined towards Islam, he would send his singing girls to this person. With the instructions, go and offer them, this person, food and drink and try to lure him and entrap him with your song and dance and your lewd ways, so that this person does not even have the desire to go and listen to the Quran anymore. And is there a comparison for that in today's world too?
Yes.
Yes. Music, singing, all which are forbidden in our deen. People are so engrossed in that, they have no time for the Quran. We do not admire the beautiful Qiraat because our minds have become so enraptured by the music of this world. All this music, that is why it's forbidden, except duff. No other musical instrument is halal. Then the disbelievers started discrediting Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam by this false propaganda, claiming that the Quran was nothing but confused dreams which Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam had at night and then recited it during the day. Sometimes they would say he has concocted all this up. Sometimes they would say that there's a man who is dictating all this to him. Sometimes they would say that these are lies which he has made up. Sometimes they would say that these are false tales, ancient stories which he had gathered and he is putting them all together in the form of this Quran. Sometimes they would say that there are evil jinns or demons who are teaching him the verses of the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
هَلْ أُنَبِّئُكُمْ عَلَى مَنْ تَنَزَّلُ الشَّيَاطِينَ تَنَزَّلُ عَلَى كُلِّ أَفَّاكٍ أَثِيمٍ.
Shall I inform you about those upon whom demons descend? They descend upon every sinful liar. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says demons do not descend on Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They descend on people who are liars, who are sinners. On such people demons descend. So Allah was answering them. Whatever they put up, Allah was answering them in the Quran. Then they also resorted to arguments with Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, arguments regarding the day of resurrection, arguments regarding the concept of Tawheed, the oneness of Allah, the unity of Allah, arguments regarding the prophethood of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They said, how is it possible that these ancestors of ours who are lying in the graves for centuries and even their bones have now turned to dust, their bones have crumbled down, you are saying that they are going to become alive again? How is that possible? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to them, tell them that he is going to make, to recreate them, to make them alive again, the one who made them the first time. If Allah can create them for the first time, why is it difficult for Allah to recreate them, to make them all over again? After all, isn't it more difficult to make something for the first time rather than to make it for the second time? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Qalam, ayat number 35 to 36,
أَفَنَجْعَلُ الْمُسْلِمِينَ كَالْمُجْرِمِينَ مَا لَكُمْ كَيْفَ تَحْكُمُونَ.
Shall we treat those who believe the same as those who are corrupt? What has happened to you? How can you believe such a thing? This was in answer to their statement that there is no such thing as the hereafter. They used to claim that once we are dead, that's the end of the story. We have never seen anybody rising from his grave. So this concept of resurrection and rising up to give an account of our actions, this is all nonsense. They said, we are not going to believe in it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is teaching them, if a cruel person was to do cruelty on this earth and he dies, is this justice? That he is not even punished for his cruelty? And if the oppressed person has borne with cruelty all his life and then he dies, is this justice? That he is not even rewarded for his sabr and patience? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted to open their minds to make them think that this dunya, the life in this world, it has a complement, which is the life in the next world, the hereafter. Whatever we do in this life, we are going to be recompensed for it in the next life. If a person has done injustice in this life, he is going to be recompensed in the next life. If a person has been a good person and he hasn't seen anything, any reward in this worldly life, then in the next life, Allah is going to recompense him, reward him handsomely. So this shows us that Allah's justice means that there has to be the next life. There is no way that the story of this life ends here. It does not end here. When this life ends, that's the beginning of the Akhirah. The hereafter has already started.
This life is our examination paper.
Yes, this is our examination hall. Not a written exam, a practical exam. Allah is watching to see what we do. And it's an open book exam. Subhanallah, Allahu Akbar. Allah has given us the Quran. Allah has given us the Hadith. Allah has given us the seerah of our Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. All we have to do is copy that and act according to that. And if we don't, then of course we should be prepared for a terrible result. And the terrible result doesn't just mean that we'll fail and be given another chance to give the exam again, there is no second chance. Because after this, there is either Jannah or Hellfire. After we pass our time in Barzakh, then there is Yawmul Qiyamah, accountability, where the balance will be set up, our good deeds and evil deeds are going to be weighed. And then those whose good deeds are more, they will enter Jannah. Those whose evil deeds are more, they'll be thrown in Hellfire, Jahannam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, ayat number, surah An-Naziat, ayat number 27.
أَأَنتُمْ أَشَدُّ خَلْقًا أَمِ السَّمَاءِ بَنَاهَا.
Allah is asking them, think, why is it difficult for Allah to recreate you again? Is it difficult for Allah to create the heavens? If Allah can create the entire universe, is it difficult for Him to create a human being? How can it be difficult for Allah, the creator of the universe, the creator of the heavens and earth? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, do they not understand that Allah, He who created the heavens and the earth effortlessly, is able to resurrect the dead? Indeed, Allah has power over all things. Surah 46, ayat 33.
أَوَلَمْ يَرَوْا أَنَّ اللَّهَ الَّذِي خَلَقَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضَ وَلَمْ يَعْيَ بِخَلْقِهِنَّ بِقَادِرٍ عَلَىٰ أَنْ يُحْيِيَ الْمَوْتَى بَلَىٰ إِنَّهُ عَلَىٰ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٍ.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also says in Surah 21, ayat number 104, just as we began creation, we shall repeat it once again. This is a promise that we have made and we shall certainly carry it out.
كَمَا بَدَأْنَا أَوَّلَ خَلْقٍ نُعِيدُهُ وَعْدًا عَلَيْنَا إِنَّا كُنَّا فَاعِلِينَ.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us it is easier to reconstruct and revive something rather than to create it from nothing. When Allah can do that first thing, create something from nothing, why is it difficult for Him to recreate it all over again? However, so this was the first argument which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala answered about the hereafter. Then they used to argue about the messengership of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They failed to believe that He's a messenger of Allah. Said, what kind of a messenger is he? He eats food like we eat food. He walks about in the marketplace buying things for his daily use, doing trade, etc. like we do. So how can he be a messenger of Allah? They fail to believe that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Furqan, ayat number 7.
وَقَالُوا مَا لِهَذَا الرَّسُولِ يَأْكُلُ الطَّعَامَ وَيَمْشِي فِي الْأَسْوَاقِ.
They used to say, what kind of a messenger is this that eats food and walks through the markets? Then in Surah 50, ayat number 2,
بَلْ عَجِبُوا أَن جَاءَهُم مُنذِرٌ مِّنْهُمْ.
Allah says they marvel that a warner has arisen from among them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes it clear to them that a warner that Allah chooses will definitely be from the same species. Why? Because had Allah made an angel a warner, what would the people have said? Oh, he's an angel, he can do all that. We are just human beings, we can't do this. And so for this reason, every messenger, every prophet of Allah was always a human being. He was always one of the people themselves. They used to say, إِنَنْتُمْ إِلَّا بَشَرٌ مِثْلُنَا. You are no more than a man like us. Surah 14, ayat 10. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala answers this in Surah Ibrahim, ayat 11.
إِنَّ نَحْنُ إِلَّا بَشَرٌ مِثْلُكُمْ وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ يَمُنُّ عَلَى مَنْ يَشَاءُ.
Allah tells the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, tell them, true, we are men like you, but Allah gives His blessings to whoever He pleases. So these were different ways by which these people used to ridicule Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. At another point in time, they said,
لولا نزل هذا القرآن على رجل من القريتين عظيم.
Why wasn't the Quran revealed to someone of great importance from either Makkah or Taif? Makkah and Taif were two big cities of Hijaz at that time. They used to say, why did Allah choose this man to send his Quran to? Why didn't Allah choose a person like me? The Quraysh chiefs, they used to say, Allah should have chosen me or somebody great from Taif. Why didn't Allah choose us? We are the chiefs. Why did Allah have to choose him? He was an orphan and he doesn't have too much money, too much wealth. Why did Allah choose him? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala answers, Surah 43, ayah 32, Surah Zukhruf.
أَهُمْ يَقْسِمُونَ رَحْمَةَ رَبِّكَ.
Will they determine how to distribute the mercy of your Lord? And then in Surah 6, Al-An'am, ayah number 124, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
اللَّهُ أَعْلَمُ حَيْثُ يَجْعَلُ رِسَالَتَهُ.
Allah knows best who should receive his message. It is Allah's prerogative, who he wants to choose to send his message to. Then they also used to say, they used to compare a messenger to a king, and they used to say, kings live in palaces, they have so many servants, they have so much wealth, so many people under them. Why doesn't this person have anything? He's such a poor man. He doesn't have too many slaves or people who are listening to him or too much money. So they used to think that messengers should be like kings. So that is why this showed us that the polytheists picked up any kind of thing they could pick on just to negate the message of Tawheed, Risala and Akhirah. So would you like to say anything about this much that we had read?
What I have concluded from this session, that we are in alarming situation now.
Yes.
Time is being repeated itself, yes, again. And I think we are now in dark era of the time.
Absolutely.
Again.
Absolutely. We are in a second stage of Jahiliya.
We are doing all these, all those things again.
Which they were doing.
Which, yes.
Yes, absolutely. If anybody was to do something right today, people would make fun of him. They would think, look at him. Yes. He's not like us. And if you try to propagate the message of Allah, definitely they would turn against you. They would try to make fun of you. They will try to discredit you. They would try to put you down. What is the reason for this? Because they do not want to change. They once even asked for the Quran to be changed. They said, why don't you change this? They don't want to change themselves. They want to change the message of Allah. This is the arrogance of the people. Even today, if we give people some message from the Quran, they say, no, 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 you are misinterpreting. This is not right. This is not in the Quran. Even without reading the Quran, they are opposed to the Quran. And the root cause for this is people do not want to change. They are used to a certain lifestyle and they want to carry on. This is exactly what the Quraysh were doing. Anything else that you'd like to say?
I think today we have lost the patience, yes, also in from our lives. We have no patience.
Absolutely.
And the early life of our Holy Prophet Hazrat Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was full of patience.
Not just Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Inshallah, we will also study about the Sahaba Karam, what they were going through, and we will discover the level of patience which today we don't have. We can't even afford to lose one worldly benefit. If we can get one worldly benefit, we'll give up our deen. Astaghfirullah. That is what people have become now. May Allah guide us all. So let's take a short break and then inshallah we'll carry on after this. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.